started with tonight's exciting festivity. Never before in the history of U.S. debating have we had two touring national championship teams from foreign countries be in the same city on the same night and agree to debate one another and allow the Americans to participate as well. We've had numerous debate tours over the history of the United States, starting in 1922 with the first British tour of the U.S., and the Irish tour, started through NPDA many, many years after that, has also been around for a long time. And now we have the Spanish tour of the U.S., which is its first year, and we're very, very happy to have them here as our guests here tonight. So tonight we're going to have a debate in the BB style. And I have turned over to the various delegations the responsibilities of introducing their delegates. So it is my job to introduce the people debating for St. John's University. My name is Steve Yano. I'm a professor of rhetoric here at the university. And I direct the debate program, which is a co-curricular intercollegiate debate program that allows any student at St. John's to participate and learn how to debate, to advocate, to argue in various forums and fashions. And it's free for any St. John's student here, so if you like what you see here tonight, you should consider joining. We're also broadcasting to Facebook, I think. It's still working. So you can go and share that. If you find find my page, you can share it with your friends, and then we'll get a big international audience, hopefully, as well. So my job is to introduce the opening opposition speakers who are from the St. John's University Debate Society. Michaela Torres, right here. She's from Los Angeles, California, and she's a junior rhetoric major, and she's here tonight to speak. And she works at the Writing Center, and she's very nice. And next to her is her partner, Eugene Gaborn, who is from the Bronx. And he spends a lot of time in our Debate Society headquarters plotting and planning his arguments for now and for the future. And both of these are very esteemed members of our Debate Society and have been to many different competitions and done very well. And they also accompanied us to our Morocco outreach program in Rabat this year and taught hundreds and hundreds of students about debate. Well, maybe more like 20. But it feels like hundreds and hundreds of students about debate in sunny Morocco. So now I will invite, from the Irish Times National Tour, I'll invite Leah Morgan to come and introduce the Irish speakers here in the debate.
Good evening, guys. It's such a pleasure to introduce you this evening, to introduce my teammates to you this evening, and to meet you all. We're really looking forward to the rest of the debate this evening. So, all three of us are winners of something called the Irish Times debate, but unlike myself, we have two actually very experienced Irish National Circuit debaters behind us, whether they're comfortable admitting to it at the moment or not. So on the left here, we have our good friend Ashley Tully, who is actually the winner of a regional schools debating competition, as well as numerous, has also been to the European Debate Championships and the World Debating Championships, and she hails from Dublin, Ireland, as same as myself and Dara. And we have Dara, who was once described as really cool by Ashling over there, but he's a good guy. Who's Dara? Thank you very much, guys.
Yeah, we're very happy to have the Irish Times debaters come here as they have so often before. We thank Pax Rhetorica and Helena Montana for the sponsorship. And we also thank the Irish Times for sponsoring the debate as they do every year. It's invaluable to us here in New York to have such accomplished Irish debaters come and share their practice with us every year. And now a new organization on the international scene is here. I'd like to invite Senor Rubio, is that right, to come forward. And to introduce the, oh, it's going to be you.
Yes.
Come forward and introduce the members of your new organization.
Well, welcome, guys. First of all, we would like to say that it's a big pleasure for us to be here debating in the United States. This is our first time debating here. And now we are going to present what the foundation is. We are a foundation of debate, of a legal debate in Spain. We are from Spain. different parts of Spain. And now we do debates. We do different tournaments around Spain, around our country. And the winners, after doing a final debate in Madrid, enjoy different trips like this. We were in Argentina a few months ago, debating against the local teams. And now we are in the United States. We were in Boston. And now we are here in New York, so this is a big pleasure and a big challenge for us. And now, well, the specialty or the thing, yeah, special in this, in our league, is that our topics that we debate are related to a legal issue, always, because we are a legal foundation of debate. So, for example, we have debated about death penalty or about different issues related to European Union, for example. Now the topic is the International Criminal Court. And now, well, a little presentation about me and then about the members of the team. My name is Raquel Cicerot. I'm studying 2 degrees in Barcelona, Business Administration and Law. And, well...
Well, thank you very much, Raquel. It is a pleasure indeed to be here. And also, thank you all for coming and making this a very big experience. I want to say, the Spanish students that came here have been selected amongst more than 100 students from all the universities in Spain. We have people from Cordoba, people from Malaga, from Barcelona, from Salamanca debating in our league. And, well, my name is Diego Rubio, and I'm going to present everybody. First of all, we have as Prime Minister Irene Villarreal. She has been awarded with the second best speaker of the World's University Debating Championships in Spanish, called Femude. And she likes studying cinema and also walking under the rain, just in case she grows up. Well, then we have Deputy Prime Minister Lucia Aparicio. She has been the She has been the best speaker of our league, best speaker of one, more than 100 students, which is very meritable. And also her hobbies are, well, she likes traveling, learning languages and making history. And here we have, she's from Cordoba, and is from Segovia, sorry. Here we got Alfredo Betancourt. He's from Venezuela, but he studies in Madrid. He studies international relations in Universidad Complutense de Madrid, and he says it's a pleasure to be here in such a wonderful date, because he said something about meeting a friend called St. Patrick's, but and he has a green tie, I don't know why, but and he believes it's fancy. So, well, thank you very much. And also, finally, we have, as a whip, we have Patricia Muñoz. She has finished her degrees, a master's in law, and she's actually an abogada, a lawyer, a Spanish lawyer. And she likes reading, going to the cinema, things normal people like, and also sleeping. So thank you very much for receiving us, and it is a pleasure. Thank you for this opportunity.
Now that you've learned everyone's name, it will be a quiz. We're going to start the debate now. The format of debate is British Parliamentary Debate. The topic that we're going to debate is whether the International Criminal Court would benefit from increased American involvement. On the government side, they will say, yes, it will. The opposition side, they will say, no, it will not. Each speaker will be given 7 minutes that they can use to make arguments to try to persuade you that they are right about the topic. The timekeeper, Lily, in the back, will keep the time through a variety of mysterious sounds that you'll hear. One of them being the single knock, which will indicate to the debaters that POIs are permitted. What that is anybody from the other side of the debate could try to stand up and ask a question, make a comment, make an argument, something like that. About 15 seconds or so is all permitted, and then they have to sit back down. So the, that's about it. It's very simple. And basically, the way you're supposed to evaluate the debate is to think, are the arguments reasonable? Are they well substantiated? Do they make sense? Are they persuasive to me? Do they correspond with my vision of the world? Or are they some kind of fantasy induced by too much candy or other substances. This is the kind of the way that we decide. It's very easy. So without any further ado for me, I'll turn over to, I think, Amber Hatcher, the Debate Society member, is going to chair the debate. Lily's keeping the time, and I'll be back with you at the end of the debate for conversation about it. So let's get started.
War crimes, torture, human treatment, crimes against humanity, deprivation of freedom, murder, cruel treatment, attack on the dignity of the people, executions without previous judgment, intentional attacks against the civil populations, Afghanistan, US soldiers, impunity. I'm very glad to propose here the next motion. Would the ICC benefit from more youth involvement? I'm Irene, and like the Prime Minister, today I'm very proud to discuss this transcendental topic for all the humanity about the human rights. Obviously, as a Prime Minister, I'm going to defend that yes, the ICC will benefit from more UN involvement. But before our arguments, we need the definitions. The ICC is an international tribunal which has the jurisdiction to prosecute individuals, not the states, for international crimes of genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and the crime of aggression. Also, the ICC complements national judicial systems, its act of last resort. According to the 17th article of Rome Statute is the statute that creates the ICC, the court only has jurisdiction when national courts are unable or unwilling to prosecute these crimes, or when the United Nations Security Council or individual states refer investigations to the court. We are going to understand about more youth involvement that the US is going to ratify the Rome Statute, is going to take part like a member of the ICC. And we are going to understand like a benefit that the ICC, US, are going to help ICC to achieve its goals on a better way. The goals of the ICC are guarantee the universal justice, guarantee the international peace, protect victims, and put an end to the impunity for the perpetrators of all of the crimes of genocide, against humanity, war crimes. So, which is the, later please, which is the statu quo now? The statu quo is that the US don't ratify the Rome Statute. The problem with this is that the ICC the US is not respect the territorial principle of the US. I'm going to explain. The territorial principle means that the ICC can claim jurisdiction both when a member state's national has committed an atrocity crime and when an atrocity crime occurs territorially within the member state. The problem is that because the U.S. Don't ratify the Statute of Rome, if a citizen of U.S. commit a crime such around the world in another country, the ICC has not the power to judge this person. Is the problem now with the troops and the soldiers in Afghanistan? The problem is that because of the US is not in the jurisdiction of the ICC cannot prosecute these war crimes that commit of the US citizens. Even if Afghanistan ratified this Statute of Rome, the problem is that US has a lot of bilateral agreements with the majority of countries of the world, like 100 countries. That means that these countries cannot prosecute and cannot give the possibility to the court to prosecute the citizen. So, for example, if this soldier in Afghanistan commits a lot of crimes, because U.S. is not ratified the Statute of Rome, has the criminal court has no possibility to prosecute, and because U.S. has the bilateral agreement with Afghanistan and with a lot of other countries, has not the possibility to prosecute in that territory of Afghanistan because this bilateral agreement. And obviously the International Criminal Court has not the possibility to prosecute the crimes in the USA, in the territory of the USA. So the territorial principle is not only about this US citizens around the world, it's true about the crimes in US. Yes, slowly please.
Why wasn't Tony Blair prosecuted in the ICC for his involvement in the Iraqi war?
I don't understand the point. Maybe if you develop in your speech, we can respond. So, our first argument is very simple. If U.S. Has more involvement and ratified the Statute of Rome, there ICC is going to have more jurisdiction. And if the ICC has more jurisdiction, it means that it's probably that we are going to have the possibility to prosecute more international crimes. Because the problem now in the status quo is the International Criminal Court has not the possibility to prosecute, for example, all the tortures and the war crimes that the soldiers of U.S. commit in Afghanistan. And we see that is an argument very plausible and is very damaging from the victims and from all the citizens to see that the U.S. citizens commit a very dangerous crime for all the society, because it's not a simple crime. It's a crime against all the humanity, it's a crime against all the people that the victims suffer. As a citizen, I can see that maybe my life is in a very dangerous risk, and there is no institution in the world that is going to protect me because of this. So we think that the impact of the involvement of the U.S. in the International Criminal Court, it's very high and very important because of the human rights all of the population around the world. Because we are going to see, like, if the ICC has more jurisdiction, it's going to have more jurisdiction because it's going to have the U.S. The ICC has the possibility to prosecute international crimes in the territory of the USA and has the possibility to prosecute the USA citizens that commit all of the crimes around the world. So we think that for this principal argument about the human rights and the importance to prosecute these all war crimes, is the ICC is going to benefit from more U.S. involvement, and we don't see damages so important that this benefit about the human rights. So for this principal argument, we are going to propose. Thank you.
So, first what I'm going to talk to you about today is the history behind the ICC and how, because of that history, we should not allow more Western involvement within the courts because of the damage that it will cause to the global rights. So, on the issue of how the ICC's history particularly affects today's debate, we need to know a few key things about the issues at hand that the ICC has had involvement in prosecuting. So, what we have seen is that the ICC has been in existence for 15 plus years. There has been 20 plus indictments. There have been 4 prosecuted, all of which who are African. We have seen that the bias that is in existence within international organizations is so weighed against persons who are not of Western descent, that persons who are not of Western descent are more so harmed by being involved in these international groups than actually gaining anything from their existence or their involvement within them. We think that the Western involvement, and particularly with the addition of the United States or the increased involvement of the United States. There's going to be even more destruction caused to the lives of persons, and we are going to see even more persons not gain justice or any sort of retribution or any sort of like, any sort of justice for the wrong acts that they committed. So I think that we've heard a lot from the previous speech about the ICC and sort of what their function is and not necessarily what their purpose is. We agree with the previous speaker that their function is to carry out prosecutions, bring persons who are accused of crimes to trial, and evaluate the claims on the basis of like their validity and like legality and things of that nature. However, we don't think that this is the reason why these courts exist. We think that these courts exist is to provide justice, like I mentioned earlier. And justice in that nature is supposed to be fair for the victims, and there's supposed to be some sort of recourse felt by those who have perpetrated the crime. We think that when you have the ICC, who has been deeply rooted or sort of deeply involved with Western nations who are basically in control of the court, we don't get any justice for persons who are bringing their cases to trial unless they are persons. Unless they are persons who are of Western descent. We think that this is mainly due to the international bureaucracy that exists within international organizations. We think that nations with less power are harmed by the process of trying to get things advanced in the fact that they don't have the same sort of bargaining ability outside of the court to actually be able to get their way within the courts. We think that what happens is the United States, being the superpower that it is, when they are involved within the ICC, they're going to have the ability to actually whip the courts into shape and into whatever place that they need them to be for that specific time. So if there are persons within Africa, Asia, or any other sort of geographic location that is not specifically America or one of its allies, we are going to see that they themselves, those persons who are not the United States allies, are going to be affected by the United States involvement within the courts from that they don't have the same ability to carry out cases that the United States will have. We have seen previously from international organizations such as the UN that many times when nations come together, we have seen sort of like stagnation caused from them coming together, mainly due to their own political interests being involved in their like joining these things. We think that the United Nations is not supposed to sort of be like this arguing playing field for nations, and is supposed to actually enact some change and create better diplomacy among nations. However, many nations, including the United States, what they do is if they do not get their way, what they do is they cause sort of like gridlock within the United Nations and sort of halt the United Nations from actually being able to carry out their mission. We think that the ICC cannot be corrupted further in this nature by allowing more involvement from Western powers when there is no accountability, and I'll get into that next, for these nations. We think there needs to be less... I'll take you 1 second. There needs to be absolved of less... Yeah, exactly. The ICC needs to be sort of like, we need to sort of drain it of the issues that they have, we need to drain the ICC of sort of the signatories that have been causing this gridlock and problems so far, and mainly and specifically for African nations and leaders. Yes.
Yes, how the ICC is going to prosecute the international crimes that the U.S. citizens commit if the USA don't ratify the Rome Statute?
So that actually leads me into my next point, which is about accountability. We think that the purpose and function of the ICC is eroded when the United States gets involved, because the United States can never be held accountable for their actions. We can list as many crimes that the United States has committed across the world and no persons have seen any jail time for. We can list out all the atrocities that the United States has sort of like incurred across the globe, and then they themselves champion these things as sort of like causes for justice, and then use the effects of their actions in these places as sort of like justification for their being there in the first place. However, what we see is that in every instance that the United States get involved in like a specific geographic location or a specific international body, we see that persons who are not of Western, nations and persons who are not of Western descent or Western alignment, they themselves are harmed because they are not aligned with the United States and other Western nations. We think accountability cannot exist without recourse for persons who are committing certain acts. We think this keeps nations and people in check because if you are held accountable for your actions, you are not going to actually act in a way that harms persons or that harms persons because you yourself will receive some sort of like retribution in return. We think that when the United States joins this can never happen because of their strong geopolitical presence and the fact that they, like the United States, has an extremely strong economy, extremely strong military, extremely strong soft power across the globe, and it has enacted their power in these different fashions to get what they want done in multiple instances. We have seen through the United Nations where there have been multiple times the United States has vetoed something that would have been an obvious benefit to persons who involved in that situation. However, it did not serve in their own personal interest, their own sort of like political interest, so they vetoed it, causing even more harms and effects to those persons involved. We think that when the United States gets involved in the ICC, we're going to see even more corruption involved, even more corruption occur within this court, and we're going to see an extremely overbearing amount of cases brought against persons who are not of Western descent, but there won't be the same sort of like accountability for nations that are of Western descent, as we have seen in the past with the current signatories the majority of the nations who are signatories that have power are of Western geographic location.
Thank you everybody for being here today. My name is Sofia, and as the deputy of the Prime Minister, I'm here to first of all rebuttal some things that the opposition has given to us, and then I'm going to explain our arguments to propose that there would be a profit if the US involved in the ICC. First of all, from the opposition, they have told us that there has only been judged and prosecuted African cases, but this is good. I mean, if someone, it doesn't matter if they are from Africa, Asia, United States, if someone commits a crime, like a genocide, like a war crime, it's good to be prosecuted. So this is a good new for us, because if someone is committing that kind of crime, it should be prosecuted. So fantastic that we have an ICC, we have a court that prosecutes these kind of crimes. And why? Because they are forgetting something very important, that is the complementary of the ICC. What happened? That the ICC prosecutes and judge and punish when the state doesn't want or doesn't or can't prosecute these cases. So if the African cases has been judged, it's because the state didn't want it to do it or couldn't. So, in a moment, I give you the point. This is a good news. We don't understand what happened with the proposal. The proposal is fantastic. It's just to gain peace, security, well-being of the world. So everything that helps this is good for us, even if it's in Africa, in Asia, in the United States. So, if the United States involved in the ICC, what happened? That a citizen from the United States can be judged, in a moment, can be judged from the ICC. And that is good because we help to the proposal of the ICC. So, your point, please?
Is it good that South Africa left the ICC because they thought that the ICC was racist and they wanted to prosecute? Is it good that South Africa left the ICC because they felt that the ICC was racist and they were prosecuted?
Well, if they left it, it's because they think the ICC is not working well, so we have to work to improve the ICC. Then, let's keep on talking. The United States cannot be prosecuted right now. We have to see that the United States is the most powerful country in the world. It's something that no one can deny. It has one moment. It has the most powerful military capability. It has also a very important troops and soldiers around the world. So right now, this is not being judged from the ICC. And we have to have in our minds, that the ICC prosecutes crimes against humanity, against war crimes. So if someone of this country commit a crime, they're not going to be prosecuted by the ICC. And this is a big problem that we have to solve. That is important that the United States involves in the ICC. We have to think that we have a bad situation right now, because the opposition has told us maybe a citizen or a soldier from the United States can commit a crime of this characteristic. But what happens if they don't want to judge it? What happens if they don't want to prosecute it? Nobody can do nothing. That's why if they involve the ICC could prosecute this and would benefit. So what happened? That with the involvement, we have a better situation. Maybe we have to be stronger. We have to get or have a better ICC. But the probability to have a better profit, a better outcome is higher if the US involved. So having this, having all the stuff from the opposition rebutted, I wanted to end with our arguments. The Prime Minister has talked about the importance of the jurisdiction. If the United States involves into the ICC can prosecute the cases coming from the United States citizens, or soldiers. But at the same time, we have an argument of legitimacy. What does it mean? And first, your point.
So, post-2017, acts of aggression can be brought to the ICC. How do you suppose that the United States, who claims to bring democracy to multiple nations, which are acts of aggression, how will they be held accountable in the ICC when they haven't been held accountable in any situation?
Yes, the ICC is composed by a lot of countries that can prosecute it if the United States doesn't want. Maybe I'm not understanding where you're questioning. If not, let me know. But if the United States doesn't want to prosecute, we have to have in our minds that the ICC is composed by judges from many other countries, for example, France, so they can prosecute the case. Then I start with our last argument, the legitimacy. Well, we have to have in our minds that the actual situation has two facts. First of all, the United States is not a singular country. It's the most powerful. As I have said, it has troops and soldiers around the world. It has a lot of influence. I have got down 2 points, I need to end. And also, the United States is not under the ICC jurisdiction. Well, how does this affect to the ICC? It loses its legitimacy. Imagine that case. Imagine that we are a class, and we know that someone is cheating, someone copying the exam, but the teacher doesn't say anything. We know that something strong is happening, but no one can prosecute that. That we know that the teacher has not the power enough to say you are doing the thing wrong. That's what happened. We see the rest of the classmates are seeing how something that is not fair is happening. So what happened if the US joined the ICC? If the US joined the ICC, that cannot happen. And also, what happened with the impact? Which impact do we have when the US, involves the ICC? First of all, the states. Every party state is under an universal jurisdiction. So the US also will be under this universal jurisdiction. In second place, the victims. We have victims that can be not see how the criminals are punished, so they have a double victimization. First of all, the crime. Second, the injustice. They're watching how the crimes are not being punished. And first of all, and I'm finished, the soldiers and the citizens. The majority of the global, because United States, states, China, Russia, or India, the majority of the population is not under the jurisdiction of the ICC. And that is a big problem. So, for ending, we are very proud to propose this because we think with a more greater involvement of the US in the ICC, we will see how the proposal of the ICC, which is guarantee, respect, and enforcement, the international justice, would be increased in a really good way.
Without justice, we'll never stand. If we allow the United States to increase their role in the ICC, any semblance of justice that we might be getting from the court system currently is going to fall and fail. What we're going to talk to you about today is why the ICC is just another example of performative justice that gets no results, that never results in justice, and never absolves or allows, continues to allow big nations to absolve themselves of the guilt that they ought to be like feeling. Second, we're going to talk to you about why the ICC is a neocolonialist institution that has uniquely bad results for a few reasons, always allowing like smaller nations to continue to be oppressed and bullied while always allowing bigger nations to scapegoat their problems and never be brought to like the actual foot of justice. So firstly, we think the ICC is an example of performative justice, not only because it's ineffective, but because we think we've seen this before, right? We saw this with war crime tribunals after a myriad of genocides. We saw the international community repeatedly absolved for not intervening in Rwanda, for not intervening in Bosnia, for not intervening or waiting to intervene with the Holocaust. However, we think that the ICC is worse, right? Because we think that the ICC is supposed to be an all-encompassing system of court that says, we're going to bring justice to the international system. Don't worry, we're going to handle it. But in the past plus 15 years, we've seen over 20 indictments, but we've only seen 4 people prosecuted. We think that the problem with the ICC is that the purpose of the government or the purpose of the court system is not justice. It's never going to be justice. And we think that if the U.S. is allowed to expand their role, we're never going to get justice. Why? Because firstly, we think they're never going to be accountable. And like Hee-John told you about this, I'm going to talk to you about this more, especially when I address their points. But we think we see the lack of accountability, not only in the lack of effectivity, but in the way in which they've established themselves and established precedent as a neocolonialist institution, right? So we think that we've seen them consistently targeting African nations. And government asks us, well, why is this a bad thing? Well, we think it's a bad thing when government, when African nations who bought into the ICC under the guise of the fact that they were finally going to get justice for all of the colonial entities that had taken over the land, for all of the people that had been killed on their lands, but instead, in a minute, what we see is 4 people prosecuted, all from African nations, 3 from the Congo, while a blind eye is continually turned to other countries in the world that are committing atrocities that are, if not worse, just as bad.
But yeah, how would you say that the International Criminal Court is a colonial organization when countries such as China, India, and the United States are in the court?
Well, we think countries like China and the United States are inherently colonialist, like for the first answer. But secondly, like, we're going to get to this in a second, and I'll flag it when we do. Further, we think that increased U.S. involvement is only going to continue to exacerbate the neocolonial precedent that we've seen already set, right? They ask us, well, we need to improve the ICC, so the way that we need to do that is to work within the system. But we've seen the U.S. work within a few systems, right? We saw them work with UN and then establish a permanent seat on the Security Council and then use it to veto anything that might hurt U.S. powers. We saw it with the World Bank, we saw it with the IMF, where the money that we're allowed to donate is consistently used to bully other nations. We don't think that we actually ever get an improvement. Instead, what we get is U.S. domination. We think that the ICC is only going to be another example for this. But we think that this is actually uniquely bad for a few reasons. Because first, it erodes a system of justice. So not only is this supposed to be, the ICC supposed to be the court for individuals to find healing, to find justice, to find reparations and reparative attributes, to find a validation of experience, or at the very least, a recognition of wrongdoing. The only way that we get this in a court system is if everybody who's operating within the court system is equal under the eyes of the law. Insofar as we know that in every other international institution, the U.S. is never equal to everybody else, we don't think that we're ever going to get them here, because the U.S. is always going to continue to tip the scales. Further, we think that what is even worse about this is now that they're operating under the guise of international engagement, they're saying, don't worry, we as the U.S. are engaging in justice, we're going to look in the mirror someday, but first we're going to look at you and you and you, we're going to prosecute you and you and you, and we're never going to say we need to be brought to justice. Why? Because we think that the U.S. is profit-driven, and we think that the U.S. is never going to do something to harm their image or harm their profit. So what this instead does is it allows the United States to dominate over the ICC, to bolster their image, to say we're going to engage in international justice, but to never do so. We think that this is problematic, and we think that we'll never get the justice that government claims that we will. But secondly, we think sovereignty is like a big issue that needs to be discussed here, right? And we think the sovereignty of the United States is at stake, but I'm not going to bore you with talking about like why United States sovereignty is important. Because we think what's more important to talk about is why the sovereignty of smaller nations is now what's being harmed, right? This is why South Africa and Burundi are leaving or threatening to leave, because they're being consistently bullied. This is why the Philippines wants to leave, because we think that the USA will always have the ability to protect its sovereignty. It's the biggest like military force in the world. It has a lot of money, and it dedicates a lot of money to protecting its image and to protecting its sovereignty. But we think countries like South Africa or Burundi or like the Philippines aren't ever able to do so. So what we see now is this colonial entity saying that we're going to prosecute the people within your nations. You're never going to be able to have a hand in how this happened. We're never going to turn and look at bigger nations that are doing the same thing, and all the while we're going to say, but we're participating in justice. We think that this is problematic, we think that this is colonialist, and we think that this only gets worse when the United States expands its role in the ICC. But further, it also absolves a lack of action on larger nations, right? This is what we saw with war-crime tribunals. This is what we're going to see here. We saw that bigger nations said, but we're not going to intervene in Rwanda, we're not going to intervene in Bosnia because it's too expensive for us. But don't worry, we're going to have a trial after. We're going to take them to court after. But what comes of that? Nothing, because we know that it's not effective and we know that it's never been effective. So what instead happens is we're allowed to say that we're never going to engage, even though colonialism is what started all these problems in the first place. Say we're going to take them to trial, watch that trial be ineffective, and then continue to throw the whip and say, but you have to act in the way that we say, or else like something's going to happen. Lastly, we think that what it does is it deters justice for smaller nations that are made victims. And we think that this is especially important because these smaller nations are supposed to be able to come to this ear and say that we are equal to the United States in finding justice. When this never happens, we've eroded the idea of justice and we've eroded the purpose of this court system. Why? Because we think as long as the United States is allowed to expand their role, they're going to continue to do things like fund Saudi Arabia and the Yemenis war. They're going to continue to commit human rights atrocities, and they're going to know all the while they're never going to be punished because now they dominate the only court system where individuals in other countries were supposed to have an equal footing. We think that they're going to continue to pretend that they adhere to the rules, that they continue to chastise other countries for not adhering to, all the while saying, we're seeking justice. We think that the United States is profit-driven. We think that they've dominated every other international system they've participated in. We should not let them dominate the ICC. We should let the ICC stand for any semblance of justice that we hope it can continue to stand for without U.S. involvement.
You're here.
Great democracy has to be progressive, otherwise it will cease to be great or a democracy. Theodore Roosevelt. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Patricia Muñoz, honorable members of this parliament, and it's a real pleasure being here debating of this interesting topic, especially with American people. I think it's very interesting to have some different opinions with all of this. Well, it is my duty as a member of the government, in first place, trying to refute and rebuttal what have been the arguments exposed by the open opposition, and then I will try to add some new arguments and trying to continue with the arguments exposed by the open government. Well, we have heard like two arguments. The first one, which was about corruption. They said that the U.S. Would win the bullet. And, well, however, let me ask you a question. why hasn't the U.S. ratified the Rome Statute? Why? Because the ICC is an independent and powerful court. That is the main reason why the U.S. hasn't ratified it until today. So, that is the reason. No, there are another excuses about the corruption of the court. The main object goal of the ICC was to create an independent and powerful institution. And as the U.S. don't want to be under a jurisdiction independent and powerful, in any case, the U.S. is going to ratify. But don't try to explain to us that it's a question about the corruption of the court, because it's totally the opposite. And let me tell you that, well, you can take here some cases about war crimes that has not been totally prosecuted, but that does not mean that the U.S. involvement by ratifying the Rome Statute wouldn't be benefit not only for the ICC, but also for the U.S. And let me explain, I will give you the point. But let me continue. The second of your arguments was about the accountability. And you say that, well, the USA has never been judged before. Why? Maybe a little bit suspicious. It's because of its great power? Wow. It's like, maybe it's a little bit strange. No, the point is, let me continue one moment. Of course, the strength of the United States is not an argument by itself. It's just a fact. The United States is one of the most powerful countries in the world. We are not saying no. But what we are trying to explain today is because of that, it's important that the U.S. ratify the ICC and become a member under its jurisdiction. What you have explained is just a fact. What we are trying to say today is that, especially in your argument about the effectiveness of the court has been undermined a lot, especially because of the United States restrictions for its effectiveness. So you cannot talk about, well, the court is ineffective, while you have been the main responsible, one of the most responsible of that ineffectiveness. Because, well, if you want an effective court, let's enter, come in, and, well, let's change the things that maybe we need to change and improve. I will give the point.
So how do you propose the ICC actually arrests private American citizens? How do you propose the ICC actually goes in and arrests private American citizens? Goes and actually arrests people.
Arrest
them, yeah.
I don't understand at all your point. How the US American can arrest the people?
Now, how can the ICC put them in handcuffs?
Thank you, because that engages perfectly with our third argument, which is the argument of the closed government. Well, and it's an argument about effectiveness, material effectiveness. And how can we measure the effectiveness of the ICC? Well, that's especially responding to your question. When we talk about material effectiveness, we talk in terms of international cooperation between the member states and the court. What does it mean? It means that the ICC, when it's carrying out any kind of investigation, needs intelligence, technology, the officials, the members of the different administrations of the member states, supporting to the court, so, and ultimately, of course, the financial resources that are needed in order to prosecute properly and to condemn, in case, if necessary, the people who have committed such terrible crimes. Because, please, don't forget that what we are debating today here is not any silly question. We are not talking about any kind of felonies. We are talking about the most terrible crimes against humanity. And we cannot afford one of the most powerful countries in the world. And what is more important than that, one of the main participants in every single war conflict all around the world. So the U.S. wants to participate in war, but don't want to be responsible for its acts. What is the message is the United States giving to its own citizens? Oh, well, you are not going to be responsible. Because, of course, you have told that the U.S. can prosecute its own members. Of course, well, sovereignty. Every single country can prosecute its own citizens. But the point is that our first argument was that the ICC is an instrument and of last resort, which means that the U.S. could, in the future, still continue
going against its own members. Only if the U.S. Don't do that, the rest of the countries could prosecute. So the U.S. in fact would continue prosecuting its own members if it is its decision. The point is that when America don't want to have Americans responsible, maybe the other countries will really want it. I don't know if you have another question. Okay. So, our arguments were clear as follows. One argument about jurisdiction in terms of the ratified of the ICC, of the Rome Statute by the US, would reduce the impunity, especially because it implies the derogation of the bilateral immunity agreements. A second of legitimacy and credibility, and what is more important, an ultimate argument about material effectiveness. Thank you.
I thank the member of government for their speech, and I call upon the member of opposition to extend their case for the opposition side here.
Significantly worse. Secondly, I'm going to talk about what the ICC can actually do and how you massively hinder that. First off, I just want to deal with a small bit of rebuttal that pretty much the entire proposition case has hinged on. That they think that because the US is now a member of the ICC, they'll just be prosecuted, and private citizens in America will just get prosecuted. That is the level of analysis that they're giving. That's an assertion. It's not true. I'm going to tell you why it's not true explicitly now. Because one, notice that the membership of the ICC is an entirely voluntary thing. If I, as a country, think that my citizens are now going to get prosecuted for actions I think are entirely legitimate, look at America and the Iraq War, I'm just going to leave the ICC and not allow them, and like still fall back on the bilateral deals that they want to talk about. Notice, like, if they allowed those citizens to actually be arrested, it would create a precedence that would not allow them to do those things in the future, which they cannot, as a global power, which we've all accepted that they are, they wouldn't allow to happen. They just leave, they wouldn't actually get prosecuted. Secondly, like, I would genuinely love to see the ICC attempt to march into Texas in a direct approach. But it goes into a further thing. The ICC simply doesn't have the resources necessary to go into these countries and actually arrest these people. They're not going to get the kind of intelligence that they want to talk about from America when they're trying to arrest a former US president. They're not going to be able to find people like ex-US soldiers who were in Iraq, because America is incredible. Genuinely, guys, you're incredible at covering up your tracks. It is impossible to find those people and impossible to arrest them. You don't get any of the effectiveness that they want to talk about. You actually create massive harms. What are those? First point on the problems with the ICC, and this mainly clashes with everything we hear from opening government about there simply being now more jurisdiction. Because look, the problem with the ICC is that everybody thinks they are pro-Western. Look at the fact that they failed to prosecute someone like Tony Blair. Look at the massive conflict that's currently occurring in the African Union, where they've had meetings between countless members about actually leaving the African Union if they continue to stay in the ICC. Because they think they're racist. They can say that simply isn't true as much as they like. It is the reason that someone like the Sudanese president was able to use that kind of rhetoric to make sure that South Africa didn't arrest him and didn't send him to the International Criminal Court. That is something that very much exists and is something they can't ignore by simply stating it doesn't. But now, that gets significantly worse. Because no matter what, even if America are like the best, like most benevolent overlords of all time, there's a perception there that they're always going to pursue their own interests. And that means that countries ultimately will just leave the ICC in droves now. And why is that thing? Because anyone who isn't a US ally, who thinks now that the US, as the dominant force in the ICC, is going to direct everyone they go after, will just leave. Why would they stay in that International Criminal Court? Secondly, is anyone who thinks in the future they may do something that is against US interests, like, I don't know, sign a deal with China, are now going to leave the ICC because they think they're going to be even more greater focus and more susceptible to being prosecuted. And anyone in an unstable region who thinks that something may descend into conflict, that may descend into the kind of war crimes that the ICC actually prosecute, will just leave, because countries, for some strange reason, don't like their sovereignty being infringed on and don't particularly like an organisation that actually practically does that. And when they do leave, they can just turn to Russia, they can just turn to China. They're probably global superpowers too. Sorry, guys, you're not the only ones. But why is that bad? Because the ICC can't do anything anymore. Like, they fail to acknowledge the three actual reasons the ICC is able to go after people. They can either investigate people in member states that those member states have referred, those individuals in those member states that those member states have referred to the ICC, which they can't do anymore because people aren't members of the ICC anymore. Secondly, they can have like cases referred to by other members, non-states that aren't part of the ICC, those individuals can be referred to by member states of the ICC. That didn't happen in the case of Sudan. Like, it won't happen now because no one will be members of the ICC. There's a trend happening here. Or thirdly, there can be a United Nations referral from the Security Council. Like, if we genuinely think that like that is a practical outcome, like I would love to see any of us try to get like Russia, China, and America to agree on any woman can be put forward that should be prosecuted by the ICC. Given that you can't get those countries to agree on anything ever, I simply don't see it as a possibility. Go.
Yes, Africa ratifies the ICC because see another countries like US not ratify, so why in Africa they ratify and US not? Because there is a lot of dictators in Africa that don't want to be prosecuted for the ICC.
Yeah, but they don't get prosecuted now. That's the problem. On both sides, dictators probably don't get prosecuted because those states would have to refer themselves effectively, and given that dictators like being in power, they probably won't do that. But even if they don't leave, even if they stay in the ICC, why is it still bad? Because you get a massive increase in the kind of anti-Western rhetoric that already exists inside the ICC. See US citizens who have already explained to you won't be being prosecuted, and increase that massively. It worked for the Sudanese president, as I talked about before. It worked for the Kenyan prime minister and deputy prime minister before, when they brought back before the African Union. And that's without US involvement. Now, they can directly point to a third party that is actively influencing that international organization and tell people that they are the people who are being racist, they are the ones who are prosecuting our people, and lends credibility to that rhetoric, and the ICC becomes hamstrung. Because then no one in those regions actually reports the people who need to be reported. If they want to talk about effectiveness, they have to deal with that. They haven't done any of their three speeches. I realize that's because I spoke afterwards, but I'm hoping that's what the government does next. But second point on what the ICC actually does. We genuinely believe the most important role that the ICC carries out in a way it actually can, is that it acts as an independent actor in the resolution of conflicts, because it hasn't been tied to a party in that conflict, like America, like China, like Russia. In a weird counterintuitive way, like, the ICC is effective because it can't prosecute anyone, so therefore people sign up to it, so therefore they can actually act as an arbiter in conflicts in the future. But they just can't do that anymore. When a state like America, who unfortunately are involved in an awful lot of the world global conflicts, you guys get around like nobody else. And when they are seen as one of the largest parties and one of the largest influencers of that international organization, then you can't simply say you are being independent anymore. That there's always a question of, are you taking a side in this conflict, and are you taking an unjust side in this conflict? It is an incredible, important role that the ICC carry out in allowing a sort of catharsis for the end of these conflicts, for allowing a sense of justice to the victims of those war crimes, and allowing those people to be seen to be put in jail. When the ICC can't do that anymore, we think it's lost all meaning, we think it's lost all effectiveness, we don't think there are any benefits to debate it to us.
Good morning, everyone. It's a week of the government. We're going to do these three things. First, we're going to refute all the arguments mentioned by the opposition. Secondly, we're going to mention the clashing points between both bench. And thirdly, we're going to establish now again why this government has won this debate. To start with, the status quo mentioned in this debate and the motion proposed by the government. During the old debate, the opposition just led justifying the status quo. They say the ICC isn't working, the ICC is just trying African countries. Some African countries, such as South Africa, is leaving the country. But they don't mention why is this happening. And this is a key point. They are leaving the ICC because nowadays, countries such as United States, China, India, or Russia aren't in the ICC. So therefore, the lack of cooperation of the United States is a problem we have to solve. They are describing the status quo. Of course, we acknowledge that the ICC isn't working right now. What we have to do is to improve our situation. We have to make the cooperation between the United States and International Criminal Court. And therefore, within this cooperation is when the international justice that we appeal in every moment is going to be effective. Therefore, they apply, they mention three arguments that I'm going to just briefly report. First, 1 second, please, I'll answer your question. First, they mention the possibility of the United States to win the court. But they haven't mentioned that the United States nowadays, being in the Security Council, can win the International Criminal Court. What's the problem with this? The problem is that being in the UN Security Council, but not being under the law of the International Criminal Court, is the reason why the United States is not going to be under the law. It's going to whip the International Criminal Court. Why is this? It's simple. If the United States in the UN Security Council can address to the International Criminal Court some cases, such as the case in Libya, but the United States isn't under the law of the International Criminal Court, we have an asymmetric situation in which the United States benefits and the International Criminal Court does not benefit. If we change the situation, putting the United States under the law of the International Criminal Court, we gain a benefit from the International Criminal Court since it can judge the actions made by the United States. So therefore, changing the situation with the motion that the government proposes gains a benefit from the International Criminal Court. Secondly, they mention the accountability of the United States, and they say the USA has never been judged. Why? Because they are not under the International Criminal Court. That's precisely what you need to change. We need to put the United States under the law of the International Criminal Court, and therefore judge presidents such as George Bush or whatever, or Tony Blair. So what we propose as government is to change the situation that nowadays is causing the damages to the African countries. Your point.
So when nations who are currently members of the ICC have persons who have committed wrong acts and do not see justice through the court, what do you tell nations who are also members and who are being brought to trial when nations on the opposite side are not?
The point is that if the court isn't working right now, it is because some countries that are powerful are not under the law. So the message we need to address these countries is that being under the law of the International Criminal Court would first increase the credibility and second increase the justice that is addressed to the International Criminal Court. Just to finish with the arguments, they mentioned that smaller countries such as South Africa or African countries want to leave. And as mentioned before, why they want to leave? And it's clear, they want to leave because some countries such as China, India, Russia, and the United States are in the court. It's the entire situation. The status quo was clear. The status quo was defined by the government. And they appealed to the status quo. We as government want to change the status quo. That's why we propose a cooperation between the United States and the International Criminal Court. Then, giving those points to the opposition, we're going to mention the clashing points that define this event. There were two. First, we talk about international justice in front of versus hegemony. And that's the point. International jurisdiction, that was the first argument mentioned by this government, isn't completely acknowledged or isn't accomplished nowadays. Why? Because some countries, as I mentioned before, aren't in this International Criminal Court. They mention in every moment that the US is the most powerful country, they don't have any accountability, and that's precisely because they are not under the law of the International Criminal Court. So in the moment we change this situation, they're going to be under the law, and therefore they're going to be accountable for the actions they make. So the point clearly goes to the government on this issue. Second, effectiveness versus accountability on our game. Our opponents from Ireland said in a question that how the United States would prosecute or would investigate citizens from the US. And that's precisely that the International Criminal Court, in its Article 86, if I don't remember that, sorry, they mention how the states can cooperate with the court in order to prosecute citizens. And this is clear. How could you prosecute a U.S. citizen without the cooperation of the United States of America? You just can't. How can you prosecute a citizen from the United States of America? Get into your hand, get into your position, the United States, and therefore use the justice judicial system of the United States to prosecute the citizen. So, therefore, we are increasing the jurisdiction and effectiveness
question.
Of the International Criminal Court having the United States on our side. Your point.
Okay, so we are happy to concede that probably on either side of the house, people don't get prosecuted. What you failed to address is our unique benefit the ICC brings, being an independent arbiter of global conflicts. Please handle that.
The ICC could benefit from this, first, from the United States participation, and secondly, if the ICC is independent and can be independent in third countries or in conflicts, the point is that the ICC isn't a normal organization. This is a tribunal, and a tribunal that has 18 judges, and therefore the United States cannot whip this international organization, cannot whip the conflict. So it is a tribunal. It is to judge crimes against humanity that has been made before. So the International Criminal Court cannot be an organization that treats to solve a crime. It has to be to apply justice, not to solve a crime. And finally, being mentioned the arguments of the position and being mentioned the clashing points, we're going to see how this government has won this event. And it was clear. We define a situation in which the International Criminal Court isn't working nowadays. It is failing to impose, that is, bring justice to the victims, and it's bringing justice to the world. So, when the United States, that is one of the most powerful countries in the world, is into our International Criminal Court, we can see that phrase that once the character, Spanish character you well know, Don Quixote, he said, "My friend Sancho, changing the world is not about madness or utopia. It is about making justice." Thank you.
Proposition's principles are admirable. In fact, we think they're quite nice in isolation, but the reality is that the point where the US gets involved in the ICC, that necessarily involves silencing smaller nations. It necessarily involves silencing people who need help and shutting them out of international discussion. That is what we stand against in opposition today. I'm going to talk about two things in this speech. First of all, I'm going to talk about jurisdiction, primarily dealing with what we hear from opening government, and then secondly, I'm going to talk about victims and getting justice and efficacy, kind of something we've heard from both teams and government, but mainly from closed government. Firstly, just to deal with this thing once and for all, in terms of why South Africa, why Burundi, why countries like Russia took back their signatory of the Rome Statute. Why do they do that? It's not because Russia and China aren't in the ICC. That doesn't affect the power of the ICC to prosecute people. It doesn't affect the power of the ICC to put people in prison or to bring them to court. Like, who's involved in it has no effect on that. The reason why they left is because they feel like the ICC favours Western nations. I'm going to talk to you specifically why that's true. In my first point on jurisdiction. Because they tell you that the reason why US involvement is so important is because it widens jurisdiction. Importantly, out of the 20 people that were indicted so far in the ICC, things are noticeable between all 20 candidates. First of all, they are normally involved in some sort of undemocratic movement. So whether they are terrorists or whether they are tyrants or dictators, they generally don't have any sort of democratic mandate. The second thing is they're generally unskilled, so they don't have massive amounts of technology, massive amounts of intel, and they generally leave behind an awful lot of evidence because they're not able to tidy up their tracks, and there's generally a lot of political will to put these people in jail and to get justice. Importantly, that's the reason why Tony Blair wasn't indicted. That is the reason why US soldiers won't be indicted, because the UK okay, because other major world powers have the ability to hide what they're doing, have the intel to hide what they're doing, have the ability to shelter their soldiers, to shelter their politicians, to shelter the people involved from these processes, because they already logically justify them in their head before they happen. What does that mean? It means that you're always going to get people from countries in the developing world being prosecuted because they generally don't have the technology and don't have the training to defend themselves. What does this mean? The US will never fit into the bracket of people who is prosecuted in the ICC if they join. What does that do? It makes it look to other countries, like the likes of Africa and Burundi, like the likes of Middle Eastern countries that are members of the ICC, that the US is being favoured because of their Western values, that the US is being favoured because of their access to capital, because of their access to technology, because of their access to money. What does this mean? That people will leave, that countries in Africa will leave, that countries in the Middle East will leave. What does that do? It makes the ICC smaller, but also those are the countries where people are put in the most danger every day. Those are the countries where you need accountability, where you need a court abroad that can actually try those people in a court that's not biased, in a court that isn't corrupt. When you take away that opportunity from those people, they're so much more hurt than what happens on their side of the house. But furthermore, any potential future enemies, as Derek points out to you, are likely to leave the ICC. Anyone who thinks they'll have a problem with the US are likely to leave the ICC. Because at the point where it looks like the ICC is biased towards the US and Western countries, even if it isn't, even if it's because they literally don't have the resources to trace down these people, that makes people want to leave because they feel less represented. But if the US is able to be prosecuted, if by some miracle the ICC gets the resources to do that, the US will literally just pack up and leave, okay? Because they have no reason to stay in a situation where their soldiers or where their people or where their politicians are being questioned for their actions. Proposition wants to tell you that the ICC will benefit from US involvement. That means they stand over the US being waived of all of their crimes done, because at the point where they think that benefit is so important, they tell you that it's more important than the US being prosecuted and leaving. That means that on their side of the house, they defend a system that is always unfair. That benefit is lost and a precedent is created where, like, Britain can't be prosecuted because they might leave, and because France can't be prosecuted because they might leave. That's so much more damaging in terms of how the ICC functions in the future. Let's talk about victims who don't get justice, because they tell you that this is now a more effective system. First thing to note, that's not true if we have a smaller jurisdiction. If I can reach less countries all around the world, if I can help less people all around the world, then I am not more effective, then I am not more able to protect people, and therefore their point in that regard falls. But furthermore, Dara tells you why specifically the ICC is so important to smaller nations. Notably, China, India, Russia, South Africa are now no longer part of the ICC. It's not beneficial for big nations to be a part of this forum. Why is that true? Because it is smaller nations who don't have a voice on a global stage, who don't have the political infrastructure or the judicial infrastructure to prosecute people, who don't have the democratic infrastructure that allows them to have a trial in an unbiased way. Those are the people who need these courts. Yeah, I'll take it.
Yes, so your proposal is to have only these smaller nations in the ICC, so the ICC is only capable to prosecute these smaller and
okay.
Not the bigger.
We stand over the ICC representing countries that benefit from the ICC representing them in the way that is most fair and most just. As it stands, the ICC is best equipped to do that for smaller nations, because smaller nations have more to gain from being part of an international organisation that has increased resources and increased training and increased skill. We think that countries, first of all, we think that at the point where smaller nations start leaving, you lose that forum for dialogue. You lose that support for smaller countries, and that means that you're more likely to see corruption in courts of smaller countries. You're more likely to see victims on the ground in countries like Burundi being screwed over because they don't have any access to a fair justice system. But secondly, let's look at countries currently in conflict, because Dara tells you that we can pretty much accept in this debate that there's no deterrent based on the fact that the ICC will prosecute you. But what the ICC does is it provides long-term solutions to conflicts. Importantly, the US is often involved in a lot of those conflicts. Take, for example, their involvement in Japan and South Korea, their involvement in Saudi and Yemen, their involvement in Israel and Palestine. All of those conflicts eventually need to be resolved. The ICC is an organisation that can do that. But importantly, it can't do that if those countries feel like they can't belong in the ICC. What we do at the point where we encourage those people to stay in the ICC is we protect those people and we create long-term solutions. We continue that forum that does create lasting peace. That doesn't happen when smaller nations don't feel listened to or don't feel represented within that forum. Look, if you really want to save lives and bring justice, you need to enable small countries who otherwise can't okay? The US will do what they want, regardless of what happens. That's pretty much something we've agreed on both sides of the House. We need to give smaller countries a voice. If they are not in the ICC, it is not possible to give them that voice. If you stand for people in developing countries who have no voice, who are victims of corruption, then you will oppose this motion. Thank you.
Someone can have the voice to judge them. So I think it's something very positive that improves the situation looking as how it is now. And also I want to believe that the countries not just look for the interest but the victim interest. And if they feel that in their country is being, or in any other country is any of these crimes, it can be prosecuted. So as he has said, I think the situation would be better when everybody cooperates and joins this call. This is my opinion.
I said that Sky is the worst idea ever. I agree with, like, long term, I would love a situation in which we did have international cooperation, which we did all agree on these things. I just don't see it happening now. I think most countries are probably really self-interested and really don't care. But I think it's probably something we could change at a more base level before we decide to force people into international organisations and force them to say hello to people that probably went to war with a couple of years ago. So.
Anything more?
Well, yeah, I share the same sentiment. Like, I think that having the United States under the ICC's jurisdiction does actually help in getting better justice for victims across the globe from the various acts. Like, you mentioned how many acts in your speech just, like, off the bat that the United States has done, just not even, like, through its expansive history, just, like, recently. And it's just a problem in that they kind of have a better hand than anybody at the table at the ICC, and when they get involved there, they'll be able to have stronger pull among those nations that are involved. So, like, long term, definitely, but currently it's really hard. It's like heartbreaking almost. It's just like, why can't you just play fair, or why can't you just, like, not screw people over, fuck you, but it's just like, eventually you'll get what's coming to you.
Okay, other questions? Comments? Tom Chong?
Yeah, I have a question on the government side. I think you guys talk a lot about the idea of justice, right? The principle of justice. We should have justice anywhere. But what do you think about substantiate your argument? I guess that's my question. Do you find it effective?
I mean, I think it's the basis for a good argument, since you can say that the principle is justice, but if you don't see it really in the real life, for example, talking about big cases or talking about real cases, it's a principle, and that's it. It isn't connected to reality now. So, in fact, you can say, for example, that the International Criminal Court defends the international criminal law and defends the universal jurisdiction, but what would you tell to a victim of a genocide? What would you tell to a victim of a crime against humanity? Humanity, sort of. They won't believe in principles. They believe in real justice, and therefore, defending this side is the proper thing to defending the victim to defend, of course, based on the principle, but landed on earth.
I think that for us, the language is a very high bias, so you can explain yourself in the way that you want, because obviously you don't have we don't think in English, so it's very difficult for us to debate in another language that is not our native language. So yes, I think that the develop of the argument is like in the status quo, you have this powerful nation that, like UK or USA, you can judge their national, or even if you can't, because they ratify the Rome Statute, they have a lot of power, so it's like very difficult to prosecute them, like in the case of Tony Blair. But the problem, I think, is that even they don't. If they ratify the Rome Statute, maybe you have the possibility, a minimum possibility, of prosecute them. And I think it's important from the USA, for the involvement of USA to involve in the ICC, because I think that we create the possibility to prosecute, and in terms of justice, I think even in moral justice, it's important for the victims and for the other countries, because you can see that maybe the court can have the possibility to function or to prosecute them. But I mean, they have the power in the ICC, but if they don't are in the ICC, they have the same power too. So I think maybe in the ICC has the possibility to do that. And even if we see that these powerful nations manipulate the ICC, maybe this benefit the ICC, because maybe the ICC is very bad and we have to see now, and we have to change the things, or we have to end with the ICC because it's not work for anything. So I think in that point it's a negative benefit that maybe we can to think the. But yes, I think for us it's very difficult to explain all these things and but I think it's a very high problem with the international organizations because if you think the states are the institutions that create these organizations and the institutions that has like the territorial power to do that. So if the nations don't want, it's the same for us in the European Union. If Spain don't want to delegate to the European Union, obviously, or the other countries, the European Union is not going to work, because the countries, international organizations need the countries to let them to work. So I think that it's obvious the international organization has a lot of problems to work, and it's very difficult to them to work.
I wanted to add, please. Only one thing, I totally agree with my colleagues, but I think it's a difficult topic, especially for you, I think. But what you have to ask yourself is, what is the role the USA wants to play in the international panorama as a whole? I mean, because we are talking about one of the most powerful countries, as we have said, but How do we want that the U.S. use all his power? I mean, because, for example, we as foreign people, not American, we see that the U.S. wants to foster the democratic principles around the world, and that's the main excuse sometimes when Americans go to the war. And then on the other hand, the U.S. don't want to participate in institutions that in which the main purpose of their creation is to prosecute injustice. So there's a little bit of maybe incoherence in the speech, because for one side they are doing one thing, and on the other side they are not completely in a coherence action. I don't know if I'm explaining this, but I think that is the vision that the people bring America has sometimes with the U.S. And I wanted to ask you, I wanted to, because for example, we were debating a lot this topic, of course, especially because we were so scared about the language. And we thought, wouldn't it be, for example, positive, because we were studying the different administrations with the ICC, and for example, here we have, well, you have Trump administration. We, of course, know that with Trump, it will never be possible an ICC involvement, but the point is, wouldn't have been positive for the U.S. to be part of the ICC, for example, now in the Trump administration, because it's some kind of external control. For example, if Trump, well, I'm explaining horrible, but you understand?
No, I understand. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, because it has its points good and points bad. For example, when you have a president that you don't know what he's going to do, maybe it's positive for the American as a whole. But that is what I wanted to ask to you.
Well, I just set this question because I'm just interested in it. I don't know. I like the question. I don't really know whether it's a good idea or a bad one. But I said it because I like thinking about it. But I don't know. I guess it depends on whether or not this idea of treaty under force, or whatever, however it says in the Rome Statute, is actually going to be a legitimate thing. It hasn't really been tested yet. Our country is going to come together and do this to non-signatories. I don't know. But I don't know if you guys want to say anything about it.
I mean, I don't actually think it'll happen unless a global superpower, or more global superpowers sign on to it, because, as it currently stands, they're specifically only targeting leaders and persons involved with human rights violations in Africa, because those are the people that they can get, that was brought up in the debate. Mm. So when you have a situation where you have non-signatories who might just have the ability to defend themselves, or the ability to sort of stagger your efforts against getting persons who have committed violations in their nation, then you would have to have even more, you would have to have even more signatories that are capable of doing that, and I don't think maybe currently they do.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it was almost tested when it was either, I forget who it was, with Mahmoud Mugabe, or al-Bashir was in South Africa for the AU, and the South African government almost didn't allow him to leave. There was a dispute whether or not they should hold him there, because he was wanted by ICC. So this was sort of a mini test, maybe. This is a couple of years ago. And then the South African government kind of, well, no, that's not really what was happening. There was some delay in them leaving the country, but I can't remember who it was. It was al-Bashir, it was Mugabe, I remember. But, yeah. I don't know, I mean, George W. Bush was a much more predictable president than Trump, and he thought that the ICC was a terrible idea, because the U.S. participating in the ICC would violate the U.S. Constitution, was his argument. So every U.S. citizen gets a trial by jury. If a U.S. citizen goes in trial ICC, they don't get that right. We have to protect the Constitution first, so we're withdrawing from the ICC. So he's like, we're unsigning it, is what he said. So Bill Clinton signed it, and I guess we just put a line through that. GWB, initial. It's okay. So.
There's also, within the U.S. constitutional system, it's set up so that the Supreme Court is the highest court of the land, mm-hmm. and this would try to supersede that. And I also think, politically, I'm a professor here, and I do a lot of work with legal and political discourse. Politically, you would never get the votes in the Senate. There are so many senators from smaller southern U.S. states who would say, like, if you expect us to sign this treaty, we would be signing the sovereignty of the United States away to a foreign agent. You could certainly never have a Democratic president or a Democratic Senate doing that, because then the conservatives would just completely say this is a coup and some foreign government's taking over ours. So at most, you would need a Republican to do that, and the it's very unlikely that Republicans would do that.
Well, I think we're out of time, but let's thank all the debaters once again for the speeches. And,